and good morning. It's Wednesday week 10 and we're back for more news and more entertainment.
Yes, hello. It's just the last episode of term and a lot has happened in the last week. We'll be taking a look at some of the footage from Union Council which happened on Thursday.
That's right, and we'll also be looking at some of the highlights from Campus Fest which was on Saturday ahead of our LA One Show special which will be released on Friday.
And we'll be soon joined by Ronnie Rowlands to discuss Council, but for now it is 11 a.m. and you're watching Good Morning Lancaster.
Welcome back, I'm Jessica Beard.
And I am Justin Chow.
Now time for the news. At Union Council on Thursday, Colin Mang, Chair of Union Council, was subject to a motion for a vote of no confidence and allegations were made to support the motion, which was proposed by Anna Lee, Lusu Councillor and VP Welfare and Community. The motion was passed 21 yes and 12 no's. It was attempted to be blocked but was put through as a secret ballot and Colin Mang was eventually VNC'd. We have asked to speak to him, but he has declined to comment so far.
Council then proceeded through the agenda and a motion to change the bylaws to disallow constitutionally FTO and Lusu officers to openly support candidates in the elections. The proposal came about due to the controversy in the recent FTO elections. The original proposal would have actually meant that no candidate could rerun for any position with the wording of the proposed bylaw change. However, after a slight amendment was made, the motion was carried and FTOs can now no longer support any candidates in any Lusu election, and JCR and CCO officers can no longer support any candidates in JCR or CCO elections, but can indeed support candidates in FTO elections.
Now, Campus Fest went out with a bang. We saw many acts live throughout the day, featuring performances from Glee, who we saw on the show last week, didn't we?
Yep.
Matt Baker, The Marties, who won Battle of Bands, BC555, dozens of dance routines from Lou Dance, Cheerleaders, to Hip Hop Society. I mean, all sorts. It was a fantastic day, and the fireworks at the end were absolutely brilliant, weren't they?
It was such a... Such a fun day. It was just absolutely fantastic. And Lusu has recently rented out an old bus that has been spotted driving around campus. The bus is logoed up with 333 and this is attempting to get students to register to vote. A British citizen, a qualifying Commonwealth citizen, or a citizen of the Republic of Ireland can vote in the general election.
On Friday morning, we'll see the first major solar eclipse to happen in Britain since August 1999. The eclipse will get to 85% totality in the morning and we'll notice a visible drop in light. This will be the last major eclipse in Britain until August 2026, when we'll witness a nearly total eclipse. And then the moon will not block out the light on Britain until 2090. I mean, that's a long time. I'm not sure we'll all be here to make it.
I'm not sure if I'll be here to make it, to be fair.
We'll see.
That's quite a while away. And in other news, New Zealand X Factor judges Willie Moon and Natalia Kills were immediately fired after the show on Sunday on grounds of bullying and harassing contestant Joe Irving on live TV. It has come to light after that Cherry Tree Records, Natalia Kills' record company, has ceased relations with her early in February for unknown reasons. We have the footage from the said event now.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am just going to state the obvious. We have a doppelganger in our midst. I, as an artist who respects creative integrity and intellectual property, I am disgusted at how much you have copied my husband. From the hair to the suit, do you not have any value or respect for originality? You're a laughingstock. It's cheesy, it's disgusting.
But don't you copy Cleopatra?
I personally found it absolutely artistically atrocious. I am embarrassed to be sitting here in your presence, having to even dignify you with an answer of my opinion.
I'm all right. Yeah, Joe.
Thank you, Natalia. You're beautiful.
To me, it just feels a little bit cheap and absurd. I mean, you're like, it's like Norman Bates dressing up in his mother's clothing. It's just a little bit creepy, and I feel like you're going to stitch someone's skin to your face and then kill everybody in the audience. But okay. Do you?
I'm going to say it. It's disgusting. You make me sick. It's absolutely disgusting. You have no identity. I can't stand it. I'm ashamed to be here.
I think I look really good, and...
I think you look good because you're dressed as my husband.
Actually, you're dressed better than her husband.
Thank you, Mel.
Thank you, Mel.
Actually, Mel needs glasses.
And that being so well behaved. Mel?
Do you know what, Joe? I don't think many people have believed in you in your life, but I tell you right now, I believe in you.
Thank you, Mel. Thank you so
much. You've got a beautiful tone. Please, don't listen.
Thank you to our judges. And look, it really sounds like this crowd is behind you, Joe, right? Did it feel good?
Felt amazing.
Keep it together,
thank you, everyone.
That was absolutely shocking.
That was terrible. How could someone say something like that to a contestant who's been so brave to put themselves on stage?
I know. I mean, to be honest, often watch the English X Factor and think, they're a bit soft, you know, they should be harsher, but that was just another league of harshness.
Yeah, that
wasn't
was it? Like they crossed the line so far, the line looks like a dot. It's horrendous.
Yeah, it was really, really
And
bad,
William Moon's not even that famous. Like, come on now. Like, how can someone who's not that famous say something like about someone who's put themselves forward as, like, a brave new artist who's trying to make it into the industry?
I know. I hope the guy doesn't lose faith and he carries on.
I hope so too. But, well, them two got what they deserved. Karma.
They did. They definitely did.
Next joining us, we have Ronnie Rowland's Lucy VP Campaigns and Communications to discuss matters of council on Thursday. Here is a quick look of the VNC against Colin Mang.
Procedural
motion,
BNC
of the chair.
Can you please clarify what qualification?
And are you referring to Colin Mang or are you referring to me? Colin Mang. So, procedural motion that Colin Mang be a current serving chair of council. As I'm sure you've all been aware, you've seen numerous occasions where the chair has been biased on issues during council, ranging from changing people's eyes and cues without their knowledge or consent until seeing them actually in the pub being published, rejecting bylaw proposals again and again due to political reasons, exploiting the powers of the chair by cancelling council without the knowledge of the rest of council, or the consultation of the rest of council, and changing the minutes without the knowledge of council. On top of this, over the election period, the chair was caught ripping down candidate posters, showing a level of bias across the union, which I feel that we should just like condemn. I feel that the chair cannot remain biased, is unbiased during, is like conducting themselves as the chair, and would call upon members of council to join me in voting with no confidence in their ability to serve as an unbiased chair.
Laura Clayson.
Okay, I have a point of information. I emailed Colin to let him know about this, as I've been informed by several officers that this procedural motion would be taking place, as I felt it was only fair to give him the chance to come along and defend himself. I told him that based on my interpretation of the constitution, it does not say that the chair has to be in attendance for this motion to go to a vote. I then offered him to send me a written statement, which I was happy to read out in his absence, if this was preferable. His response entailed his belief that the bylaw specifically says that the meeting has no confidence in the chair. This can be used if members feel that the chair's decisions or ability to chair the council are damaging to their debate or process. And he said that as he won't be chairing the meeting, there is not grounds to bring this procedural motion against him, suggesting that the procedural motion has to be specific to the meeting. He said that if it was brought up, it would apply to Frankie, who is sitting in the chair, not him, as he is not the chair for this meeting. However, after discussions with staff and other officers, I've pointed out that he is still the person elected to the role of chair. Frankie is still deputy chair in his absence. He just takes on his responsibilities. In the same way as that when I'm absent, Damon takes on my responsibilities, but only in an acting capacity. So when this happens, Damon does not become the president. So people can still vote of no confidence, me, not Damon. Sorry, babe. The fact that the quote provided from the Constitution also uses the word can implies that this is not exclusive, so it doesn't necessarily have to be specific to the meeting in hand, and therefore I propose that a procedural motion can still be taken on this. I also said once more, if you really cannot come along, because I know he's doing some stuff for Campus Fest, then please do submit something in writing as a defence, which I offered again to read out on his behalf, as I thought that was only fair. And then we had a bit of back and forth about whether or not he was resigning, and he said he was retiring, but once we've actually had the discussion again, he is still in the position of chair, so that's the context. So I guess council needs to decide what
that was said earlier. Anna Lee is VP Welfare and Community Elect. Now, we've got Ronnie here in the studio with us today. Hello.
Hello, yes. Current VP Campaigns and Communications, not elect.
Yes.
And not for much longer.
So, can you tell us what went on? Because it caused a big storm, didn't it?
Essentially, the chair of council, Colin Mang, was not there. That's the first thing you had to remember. He wasn't there. And then, as you saw in the video, a motion of no confidence was moved in someone. And he was accused of a load of stuff that he'd been accused of in a previous meeting. And they were allegations that he'd refuted. You know, it was stuff like he cancelled a meeting at short notice, he blocked agenda items for political reasons. You know, I mean, you may as well have accused him of framing Roger Rabbit in the Sharon Tate murders. I mean, he wasn't there to defend himself. You know, this whole litany of depravity. And it also showed a complete lack of understanding of the purpose of a procedural motion. Yeah. A procedural motion is moved in the meeting to be reactive to stuff that's just been said or done that people feel is incompetent or inappropriate. It's not something to use to dredge up someone's past or their past misdemeanors and to use against them in that way. And I, as a result of that and a litany of other things, which I'm sure you'll be rolling VTs on later, I've decided to withdraw from council and refuse to humble myself to the body any further because I was losing it. I could not believe what I was witnessing. Mm. In the 800th anniversary of the signing of the Magna Carta, and we suddenly consign natural justice to the toilet in that way. It sets a precedent as well. It sets the precedent that actually we should use motions of no confidence to get at people who have annoyed us, right? How many students do you think care about fee and rent increases, or social space, or their socials, or their sports, or whether or not their lecturers have decent resources to teach them? A veritable cross-section, I would say. How many people, students, care about whether or not Colin Mang cancelled a meeting inappropriately? About half a dozen? And it was the bugbears of half a dozen people that we spent like 25 minutes debating in that meeting and not stuff that's actually relevant to students. So, yeah, that's what happened. A motion of no confidence was moved against Colin Mang in absentia, and the majority of that room thought it was an appropriate thing to do.
So you'd say it was done democratically but unfairly?
Yeah, it was done democratically. Yeah, I mean, people were saying, oh, it's democratic. It's like we could democratically vote to have a policy on horse doping. That doesn't mean that, you know, I'm going to support it or be in favour of it. I think that they use their abused their democratic right in a lot of ways and used it very unfairly and inappropriately.
Yeah, there has been a lot of talk in terms of this as a more of a personal politics motion rather than actually caring about the students themselves, like student body, and whether that actually matters to them. Mm. And that has been an ongoing issue with council that a lot of people have been saying it's just a battlefield for personal politics.
Oh yeah, I'll tell you something. I mean, I used to be chair of council for 3 terms, very miserable period. There were some wonderful times, but some very bad times. I'll give you a rundown of that meeting. Mm. Start of the meeting, sea of hands shot up. We have a problem with Colin Mang's chairing and we're going to talk about this. Then we get to information and questions. Sea of hands shoots up. We don't like the way the Vice President Education formats his information and questions, and he swears in them, and it's so inappropriate. We're going to talk about this. Then the motion on FCOs being able to endorse in elections. We all have a problem with the way a certain VP endorsed a candidate in an election, and we're all going to kick off about this and talk about it. And then a paper from Lizzie Horton about the fact that we've managed to achieve a route onto Senate, the highest governing academic body in the university, to achieve things for students. Not a single hand. One person, I think it was Lee Dudding, actually, asked a question on that paper. Everyone else, what? I don't understand. This is one of the most important items we had on there. And no one had, hardly anyone had read it. No one was interested in discussing it. They were just interested in coming in and, you know, getting at the people who personally annoyed them. And I don't understand. There are people who say, well, council isn't doing enough to service students. And then in the same breath say, right, let's have a discussion about council for 45 minutes. How do you live in a... It's a state of cognitive dissonance that must be very painful.
So are there others that see this problem? Would you say that... Because surely you're not the only one.
I don't think I'm the only one, and there probably are others. There are others who see this problem, but then exacerbate it by... For example, when I announced that I wasn't attending council anymore and read off my litany of disgust with that body... someone actually commented within seconds, well, this sounds really bad. Maybe it should be on the agenda of the next council. No! You're missing the point. So there's lots of people who do see it. And actually, I think that the reason that body isn't functioning well, in my opinion, is not because of how it's being chaired. It's because of how it's being used by its members. Here's how I always use council before I became FTO. I would find something out, a piece of important policy or something that was happening. I'd do some research, I'd talk to students, I'd bring it to council, we'd have a debate, and then we'd vote on how to go forward. You know, it oscillates. Sometimes there are good and bad periods of council. I've seen good ones and I've seen bad ones, and this is a bad one. It's just not being used correctly at all, in my opinion.
I don't really know how it works, so can you explain? Is there any way of overturning a VNC?
Yes, and I believe, if it's found to have been out of order, and I believe that it was out of order, I believe that, okay, so to be really boring and procedural, the motion of no confidence was moved against the chair. But Colin wasn't there. It was Frankie Phillips, the deputy chair, standing in and acting as chair. So I thought that motion of no confidence, were it to be put, could only be directed at Frankie Phillips because he happened to be the one in the chair. So I think it was, and I think it was unconstitutional in that respect. But even as a matter of principle, I don't want us to reach a stage, I don't want us to have precedents where people think that this is a way to use procedural motions. Because it shows you don't understand what procedural means. It's not a motion, it's a procedural motion that you use to react to stuff in the meeting. That's what it's for. So, and it's a dangerous precedent.
So will Colin be doing anything to reverse it?
No, you'd have to ask him.
Okay.
I know, correct me if I'm wrong, but I do believe that was Colin's last council as chair.
Yes, it was. It would have been the last meeting he was ever going to chair anyway. Yeah, so you couldn't wait 2 hours, really? Yeah, it was his last one as chair. So he would have been replaced at the next meeting anyway.
Yeah, so from that sort of, if you were to look at that sort of point, it could seem like the people who were supporting this motion were to make a point against Colin.
That is how it came across to me. You'd have to ask them what their motivations were. I believe it is what the motivations were.
Okay, well, that's not the only thing that happened, was it?
No.
So let's take a look at the motion that's put forward against FTO voting.
Supporting elections, so
Pose,
I believe, is
dubious.
Yes.
This is my second time.
I'm sorry.
This is a motion, equality in elections, and this looks at candidate endorsement at all levels, so from full-time officer level, JCLL and the CCO level. If this motion were to pass, it would mean that current FTOs cannot endorse people in any elections, any looser elections. So. It would mean that current JCR members should not endorse people who are running to come onto a JCR. Current CCOs should not endorse candidates who are coming on to be CCOs and running to be CCOs. To support this, we've done a survey of students, and 80% said they know who at least some of the full-time officers are, and over half said that if an FTO endorsed a certain candidate, that would influence their opinion on whether to vote for that candidate or not. We also believe that this adds to this policy we have at the moment adds to a cliqueiness that already exists within LUSU, and it affects whether people want to run for positions, because if they feel that an FTO is endorsing a candidate, then they are less likely to run for that position. Also, if an FTO is on a candidate's campaign team or endorses a candidate, they are likely to be privy to information other candidates don't have, making sure to level playing field. And I believe that this council and LUSU should aim for democracy in its way it works. So, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to allow one final comment on the general motion, which from Ben Kay, and then I'd like to move the discussion more to the actual wording. As I said earlier, this we are voting on both the motion and the associated bylaw changes. So I think it's important that if anyone does have anything to say about the wording of the bylaw, then they...
Just going back to what Chris says, the actual wording itself implies that you cannot rerun, because that is them personally endorsing yourself. I'll read it out. No LUSU officer shall take a position in favour or against any candidate in a LUSU election where the officer's team role is up for election. Which implies that, that to me, says any candidate means I cannot support myself. So can we amend that, please?
Other than themselves, we could add that.
Now, Ronnie, can you just clarify and explain what happened regarding this?
Well, I'll give you a history lesson. 2 years ago, okay, so before 2013, it was always in our constitution that a full-time officer would not be able to endorse candidates publicly like that. And then in 2013, when Steve Smith was president, he, I recall, moved, it was either him or the vice president, moved a bylaw change so that FTOs could support candidates in elections. And then 2 years down the line, and all of a sudden, we've changed it back again. We've changed it so that full-time officers are not allowed to use Facebook or social media to support candidates in elections.
What brought this up?
I didn't propose the motion, but it's my understanding that it was in response to the Vice President Welfare and Community supporting a candidate in that election.
Yeah.
It went to council. Okay, I'll tell you this. I lost that particular election. Do you know how little interest I have in changing the rules as a result? You'd have to open up the floor for me to reach down far enough. Right.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was people felt that it was inappropriate for FTOs to be openly backing candidates in such a way. So they moved this motion. That's why they did it.
Surely there would be, given that we had two rerunning officers this year in the election, surely that would have created some sort of conflict at the workplace.
I think that's something that actually Ben Kay raised. I might be wrong. It was a good sort of contradiction that he raised. But essentially, my argument in this was, I mean, I abstained on the vote. I didn't care either way how it went. Mm-hmm. But I had 2 points. I recognise that seeing a full-time officer back someone can be very alienating to the person who isn't being backed. They can feel completely alone. It's a very difficult, stressful time. Mm. But at the same time, I, as a sitting FTO, was quite adamant on social media that Ronnie Rowlands guy should be re-elected as Vice President Campaigns and Comms. And it sort of fell flat on his face, really, didn't it? So it's not an exact science. Generally, the people that the full-time officers back are people who have come up through the LUSU system anyway and are sort of the obvious candidate, as you might call it. Mm. You know, you could put a LUSU wonder kid against a fisherman's dog, right? And if the LUSU president starts supporting the fisherman's dog, that doesn't mean he's going to win. You know, it's sometimes just natural that way. And so the point I'm making is it's not an exact science. We can't sit here and say it will prevent this or it will cause this. We don't know. Stop talking
but
like
don't,
we do now.
Don't you think it could be highly advantageous to certain candidates to have backing like that?
I'll put it to you this way then, because it can be advantageous, and other times it can't be. But I'll give you an example. Supposing you've got a full-time officer who's really unpopular, not very well-liked, everyone hates him, always sits in the bar on his own, it sounds like me, everyone hates him, and they endorse a candidate. And in the same elections, a really popular person, you know, always at the sugar house, always partying, gets loads and loads of attention, you know, loads of girls on his arm, everyone loves him to bits.
Sounds like me.
And yeah, and he backs someone, they're more likely to garner the support and, you know, the influence votes than the FTO is really unpopular. Mm. So yeah, it can be advantageous, other times it can't be. I don't think that, you know, the right thing to do is to silence...
But, I mean, the danger is in whether they're backing a candidate who is, in fact, just their friend, or someone who has, as you say, kind of climbed up the rungs of, you know, student union.
Yeah, but that you're always going to get that. You're always going to back your friends. People who aren't FTOs are going to back their friends anyway. And, you know, they can back their friends. They can back their mortal enemy. They can back their secret lover for all I wish, for all I care. You know, it doesn't matter. I don't think it makes a difference. I really don't think it's worth pettifogging over. And I say this as someone who lost an election to someone who was backed by an FTO. That never figured. I've never looked at that election and thought, well, I can see why I lost. Because I don't regard that as being the reason I lost. There was some other one. It just doesn't bother me.
So do you think with the FTO endorsing certain candidates in an election would sort of add on to the whole personal politics within LUSU?
Could you repeat the question?
So, if you think sort of FTO endorsing candidates in a sort of an election, would you think that sort of adds the element of personal politics into LUSU at the moment? Because given that we have this sort of whole personal politics war going on already, that's been talked about.
Yeah, but the personal politics in that sense was wasting time that could be spent discussing students. And what you have to then start saying is something far less objective, which is that in some way you endorsing your friends is, you know, screwing students over in some way. I mean, you know, it is entirely subjective whether or not a candidate is good. If I were to back a candidate, it wouldn't be right for people to come to me and say, well, what you're doing is very selfish and you're going to destroy the union by doing this. It's not an exact science. Yeah. We don't know. It's so iffy on either side that we can't make any call on it. In my opinion.
Well, anyway, thank you very much for joining us today, Ronnie.
You're most welcome.
Yes, thank you. And now, as we promised earlier in the show, here's the highlights of Campus Fest. I mean, that was amazing. It's always brilliant, isn't it, to have Campus Fest?
It was such a good day, generally. It was just so much fun. Just seeing everything that's been going on for like hours and hours, and you never get bored of anything.
Can you imagine all the rehearsals that have taken place for that?
I can.
Gosh. And there were so many people for the fireworks, weren't there? It was really nice to see.
And they did a Disney medley, which just...
I know.
Let It Go was just really like good. So good. I was like... Ugh.
Everyone was actually singing along to that, weren't they?
Oh, I love that. It was just so, so good. It was such a good day.
It really, really
It was a bit chilly, though, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, I expected it to be a bit warmer. Maybe that's why people kind of held off in the afternoon.
Yeah, not a lot of people were there in the afternoon, were there?
It grew, though.
It got massive.
Huge, huge audience by the
end. Huge crowd. Yeah. Anyway, so coming up on campus, tonight at 7, County are hosting a Harry Potter-themed quiz.
And Friday is the last day of term, so we're sure that everyone's going to be celebrating that, but just make sure to be safe.
Yeah, if you're going to get Larry, don't get too Larry. Next term, we'll only be having one more episode of Good Morning Lancaster for this academic year.
I know, that's right, isn't it? Seeing as exams and deadlines will be upon us, we made the decision to kind of stop producing the show. I think it's going to be too much, isn't
it? It's going to be a lot
of
work.
Too much to do. Anyway, week 21 will mark the final show of the year. However, we'll be starting a very new, a brand new entertainment show, Just In Time, with Justin Chow from week 2 onwards.
That is very exciting. And we will be, of course, seeing coming up on campus in week 27 onwards.
And finally, please remember to register to vote to have your say in the May general elections.
Thank you for joining us in our penultimate episode. We'll see you next term for the last Good Morning Lancaster of this academic year.
Bye.